Welcome everyone. Thanks for joining our webinar today on CubeVault. I'm your host, Tomal. Today with me, I have Saqib Al-Amin with me. He's an engineer, a software engineer at AppsCode. He's a developer on the CubeVault project. So he's going to talk about how you can manage HashiCorp Vault in a Kubernetes native declarative way using CubeVault. Saqib, floor is yours.
Yeah, thanks, Tomal. So hello, everyone. Welcome, and thanks for joining in. Today's webinar is all about HashiCorp Vault and managing it in Kubernetes, as Tomal has already mentioned. I'm Saqib, software engineer at AppsCode and one of the engineers behind the CubeVault project. So let's see what's in it for us today. So yeah, here is our table of contents. So first of all, we're gonna take a look at what is secret and how we're gonna manage secrets in Kubernetes, how you can consume external secrets in Kubernetes, what are some of the practices, and what can be your go-to options. And then we're gonna see how we can manage Vault in Kubernetes in Kubernetes native declarative way. Then we're gonna do a side-by-side comparison between operator and Helm charts. And then we are gonna see the CubeVault and its features. And at the later half of this webinar, we're gonna see a demo. And at the end of the session, we're gonna have a question and answer session if you have any. And at the top of the slide, you can see the link of the talk. So you can post your questions. We're gonna try our best to answer all of your questions at last. Okay. So now let's set some common ground up front. Right. So what is a secret? What do we understand by a secret? So a secret is basically a credential, a configuration, an API key, or any other pieces of information that is required for an application, either at build time or at runtime. An example of a secret could be username or password, TLS certificates, or any other pieces of sensitive information. So what's our pain point? There are several security risks affecting the built-in Kubernetes secrets mechanism, as we know, which users actually should pay a lot of attention to. For example, your data, your secret data is stored in etcd, right? And by default, etcd data is not encrypted, and neither are your secrets. On the other hand, commonly, secrets are configured using JSON or YAML files, and with the secret encoded in Base64, if you share or check in this manifest file, the secret will be compromised. And this makes it difficult to manage secrets as part of your development workflow. So you can't basically share the manifest file or check them into a repo. Again, even if the secret is stored and transmitted securely, an application consuming the secret may store it unsecurely, may even log it or transmit it to a third party without even letting you know it, right? Secrets are critical to the operation of many services and can break a service in production if the credentials are missing or even wrong. So in order to manage a development pipeline and troubleshoot production issues, you need to track changes to the secrets. And Kubernetes provides an audit mechanism, but it's not that straightforward. And there is no way to track these changes to secrets using the version control system. So there is no clear visibility or change management in the current Kubernetes secrets management way, right? On the other hand, once a user is allowed to receive a particular secret, that user receives the secret decrypted, right? And it would be much better to define granular permissions that specify who can encrypt a secret and prevent anyone from directly decrypting that secret. And secrets should be only decrypted on demand when they are actually needed. Unfortunately, Kubernetes doesn't allow this right now. So what are the options that we currently have for consuming external secrets? Let's take a look at them. So you may modify your application to fetch the external secrets from the external API directly. This may not be possible always depending on your deployment. This may be expensive to implement these changes. And even if you are targeting deployment, again, against multiple providers, this will need to be duplicated, the same thing over and over again, right? And you can also use to duplicate your secrets into Kubernetes secrets by using controller. That's one option. On the other hand, you could also use a sidecar to fetch and write secrets, which may be injected using mutating webhook, but it may add additional operation complexity that you do not want and you want to avoid actually, right? So lastly, we're gonna emphasize on this throughout this demo. You can use secret store CSI driver. So the secret store CSI driver that uses container interface, it gives us a familiar file system, mount experience, it's pluggable and support multiple external secrets providers without even having to change your application or your pod YAML. It also provides supports to rotation and syncing secrets to Kubernetes. So managing Vault in Kubernetes way can really be a tough job, right? So Vault, what does it do? Vault primarily provides a centralized, a robust mechanism for encrypting secrets and granting access to secrets. All these tools like Vaults actually support Kubernetes, but unfortunately they are not purposely built for container workloads. You may use Vault CLI, ACL files for interacting and configuring Vault, but how to do it in a consistent and simpler way, rather in a Kubernetes native way? So what could be your go-to option? An operator on Helm chart? Yeah, it could be this painful, right? So let's take a look at this side-by-side comparison between Helm and operator. So using Helm, you can easily get started without no additional tool requirements. But in case of operator, you definitely need to install the operator first. In terms of Helm, some basic understanding of Helm is sufficient to get you started, but you need to be able to understand some specific custom resources if you want to work with operators. And some pitfalls of Helm maybe, only if you deploy a particular resource using Helm, it will simply just deploy it, right? But it will not be aware of the resource lifecycle. But if you use an operator, which is specialized for particular resources, for example, KubeVault is specialized for Vault, then it is aware of the complete Vault lifecycle. Helm gives you no self-healing, so user will be in charge of fixing everything. But on the other hand, some operators can be really smart enough to fix some common problems automatically. Using Helm, user will be in charge in any data operations. For example, if you want to manage Vault, you need to create some policy, you need to bind that policy to some users, you need to be able to create secret engines, everything manually, right? But using operators, the operators will be able to handle this data operations for you as well. So considering these pain points and these use cases, KubeVault came into picture. So KubeVault by ApsCode is a collection of tools for running HashiCorp Vault on Kubernetes. The KubeVault operator makes it easy to deploy, maintain, and manage Vault servers in Kubernetes. It also supports various secrets engine management, policy management that we're gonna see throughout this demo in the Kubernetes native way. As a result, you can use GitOps with Vault server management, and KubeVault makes Vault GitOps ready. So let's dive into the features of KubeVault. So first of all, who would want to manually initialize and unseal a Vault server, right? Using the secret key. So KubeVault will provide you auto initialization and unsealing of Vault. You may choose your preferred KMS provider, or you can even use Kubernetes Secret to store your Vault root token and even your unsealed keys, and KubeVault will automatically unseal your Vault. In this demo, we're gonna use Google KMS GCS at the later part to demonstrate it. KubeVault will provide you dynamic phase reflection. It may be very helpful for you to log into your pods and see the different states of Vault. And this is a final phase of the Vault, which is ready. And you can see all the transition time and all the status and types of the KubeVault status. Currently, the KubeVault phases are initializing, sealed, unsealing, critical, ready, and not ready. And we'll see it more of it during the demo. KubeVault also provides you accidental deletion prevention. KubeVault supports termination policy so that an user can actually clean up his resources accordingly or even prevent any accidental deletion of the resources. Because definitely you wouldn't want to delete your production grade resources accidentally, right? KubeVault also provides you Vault policy control. As you already know, everything in Vault is path-based, and so are the policies. So policies provide a declarative way to grant and forbid access to a certain operations in Vault. And policies are denied by default, so an M2 policy grants no permission in the system. So using KubeVault, you will be able to create Vault policy, and you will also be able to bind that policy using Vault policy binding CRD to machine or any other service account. KubeVault provides you these authentication methods, for example, AWS IAM, Azure GCP IAM, Kubernetes, TLS certificates, token, user pass. You can use your preferred authentication method using KubeVault. KubeVault provides you various storage backends. For example, we have Azure, DynamoDB, etcd, GCS, in-memory, MySQL, Postgres, AWS S3, Swift Console, and finally Raft, which is recently added. Each of the backend has its pros and cons and advantages and trade-offs. So according to your needs, you may choose a storage backend according to your requirements. Again, KubeVault helps you manage secret engines. You can create AWS secret engine, or you can create secret engine role, GCP secret engine, Azure secret engine, and KubeVault support also database secret engines. Currently supported database secret engines are MongoDB, MySQL, Postgres, and Elasticsearch. During the demo, we'll take a look at the database secret engines of Elasticsearch using KubeVault. Again, an user can make database access request, and the admin, on the other hand, can approve or deny this request using our KubeVault CLI. Now, KubeVault works seamlessly with the secret store CSS driver that I discussed earlier. We'll see more of it during the demo. And lastly, but not the least, KubeVault provides you monitoring via Prometheus. Now, before moving to the demo part, here is a couple of links that I have provided. So you can get your KubeVault license, the community version, or even the enterprise version from the provided link. And for installation, you can use the link below. Our currently community version supports only the default namespace, but if you use the if you want to use any namespace, then you need to get a license. Okay. And for the installation, here are a couple of instructions. To get started with the demo, you need to install the KubeVault Enterprise operator. You can install it by using this command. And you can install the secret store CSS driver. And also, you will need to install the Vault specific provider for the secret store CSS driver to work. I have already installed this in my time cluster that I'll show you in a while. So now let's think about deploying Vault server declaratively, right? Using the custom resource CRD. So Vault server CRD provides you a declarative way to deploy Vault server. You need to obviously mention the kind of Vault server. You can provide the name and the namespace and the version you want to deploy and the number of replicas you want. And you can mention the backend, for example, Raft I'm using here. And for Raft backend, you need to mention the path where you want your data to be stored. And in the ancillary option, you can give the number of secret shares and the secret threshold, obviously. And for the ancillary mode, you can use various options like we saw earlier. And for today's demo, we are gonna use Google KMS GCS. So you will obviously need to provide your necessary information for configuring Google KMS. And for the credential secret, I will need GCP credentials as in secret. And Vault will be using the monitoring using the Prometheus. And termination policy I have set to do not terminate for this demo purpose. So now let's take a look at my setup. So as I said, I have already installed the KubeVault Enterprise and the Secret Store CSR driver and the CSR provider in the Kube system namespace. So in this demo purpose, I'll be using the demo namespace. So let's create the namespace first. Now, to provision the Vault server, I'll need to configure my Google GCS KMS. So I'll need to create a particular service account credential secret. So let's create that first. Let's get that secret. So yeah, I have created the GCP credentials. Now let's deploy our Vault server. While our Vault server is getting ready, it should store the Ansible keys here. And we can see the Vault server status. And we can see the Vault server phase is changing, phase is updating here. Let's wait for the Vault server to get ready. So we have our Vault root token, Vault Ansible keys stored in the Google KMS. Vault zero node is up. Let's wait for them. So we can see in the phase, our current replicas is 1, but our desired replicas 3 and different phase. And we can see this phase reflecting in the Vault server status, which is currently critical. Let's wait to get it ready. It will be ready once while the pods are up and it should be taking in a moment. So we have 2 replicas ready right now. Yeah. Now we can check the status. Now we can see that all our desired replicas is ready. Now what we can do, we can download this Vault root token. And I'm going to decrypt that token using the gcloud CLI. And for that, I have already exported the necessary variables in my environment. And let's decrypt it in my current directory. So if I check it, I have the Vault root token in my current directory. Let's export it. Let's port forward it from the Vault. And check the Vault status. We can see our Vault server status. The seal type is Shamir. Vault is automatically initialized by KubeVault operator and which is also unsealed. And we can see our storage backend is Raft. Current active node is Vault 0, which is active and which is highly available. Now, what our goal is, we want to generate dynamic database credentials using KubeDB provided Elasticsearch and mount them into a pod using the Secret Store CSI driver. So to do that, I have already installed the KubeDB Elasticsearch in my client cluster. Let's take a look at that. So I have Elasticsearch pod up and running in my DB namespace. Now, we'll go step by step, all right? So first of all, what we want to do, if you want to provision our dynamic database credentials, you need to enable your Elasticsearch secret engine for that particular database, right? So let's do that first. So what's the secret engine CRD? Let's take a look at that first. So secret engine CRD is a Kubernetes custom resource CRD, which will enable you to create automatically the Kubernetes secret engine in a native Kubernetes way. So in the spec section, you see the Vault reference that we're giving here. And in this part, we want to give the database reference, which is Elasticsearch, and which is in the demo namespace. And we want to provide the path. So path can be anything. If you don't provide the path, it will be defaulted as database. So let's deploy our secret engine CRD. So we can see our Elasticsearch engine is successfully provisioned. Now, what we want to do? Now we want to create the secret engine role, right? So we have created the secret engine. Now we'll be creating the secret engine role. Let's take a look at the CRD first. So our secret engine role will be responsible for creating a super user role here. So we are providing the name and the namespace. And again, we want to provide the Vault reference and the database reference and the path we provided earlier and the created statements under which the secret engine role is super user role will be created here. So let's apply the secret engine role. So we can see our ES super user role has been created successfully. So after creating the secret engine role, the admin can create some sort of policy, right? So what's a Vault policy? So a Vault policy is a CRD that will grant some sort of permission, some sort of capability to a service account or to some users. So in the Vault policy, you need to provide the name and the namespace and the Vault ref. And in the policy document section, you need to provide the particular path where you want to provide your permission and the capability you want to provide. So we want to provide just the capability of reading this particular path. So let's deploy that, our policy. So we can see our policy has been created. It's the ES trigger policy. Now what we want to do, we want to bind this policy to a certain user. So we want to bind this Vault policy that we just created to a service account using the Vault policy binding. But before doing that, let's create our Vault policy. Let's create the service account. So we want to create the service account in the test namespace. So let's create the namespace first. So I've created the test namespace and let's create the service account. So we've created our service account and now apply the policy binding to the service account. So we see that our ES reader role policy has been created and it's been binded with the service account we have just created. And the service account is just a simple service account in the test namespace, which is namely the test user account. So we have created the policy binding, and we have bind that particular policy to a particular service account. Now, what we want to do, we want to create a secret provider class using the secret stored CSI driver because we want to mount our Elasticsearch credentials into a pod. So let's create the secret provider class. So our secret provider class has been created. Let's take a look at the CRD. So our secret provider class helps with configuring a particular secret provider. So our Vault DB provider, which is in the test namespace, and it's a Vault specific CSI provider. You have another a couple of CSI provider, for example, Azure, GCP, AWS, but we're using the Vault specific provider here. And in the parameter section, you need to provide the vault address. So our vault is currently in the demo namespace and the role we have created earlier. And we want to read the username and the password that's created by the Elasticsearch. And we want to read from this particular path and mount them in the pod under this name. So we've created that. Now what we can do, we can mount these credentials into a pod, right? So let's create our pod. Before applying our pod, let's take a look at YAML. So it's a very simple pod YAML, which name is demo app in the test namespace. And we need to provide the service account name, the test user account we have created earlier. And I'm putting an image here. And in the vault mount section, you need to provide the mount path where the credentials will be mounted inside the pod. And the volume section, we need to provide the name, which is secret store inline. And in the secret provider class, you need to provide the name of the secret provider class we have created earlier, which is vault DB provider. So before doing that, let's watch our test namespace. Now let's apply the pod YAML. If the secret is generated successfully and successfully mounted into the pod, then the volume will be attached and pod will be started running. So let's apply our pod YAML. So we can see our container is creating. And there we go, our pod is up and running. So let's log into the pod. So we can see I have logged the username and password, which is not very clever thing to do, I guess. So, and in the app and the image inside the pod, we'll basically make a GET request in our Elasticsearch health. And we can see the Elasticsearch health, which is status green in here. So our secret engine has been successfully enabled. We have created the vault policy and we have binded the policy to a service account and we have successfully created the secret provider class. And using that class, we have used a pod to mount the secrets into a particular pod. So now I'm going to demonstrate the highly availability and the disaster recovery part of Kubevault. If we port forward from the vault again, we can see the vault status. Now let's try deleting a couple of pods. So we are actually deleting the pod 0 and pod 1. Let's see how it behaves. The vault 0 and vault 1 is currently terminating. And we can see that the status has been reflecting here. So vault 0 is currently initializing phase. We want to get them running first. So vault 0 is up, now vault 1 is running, initializing phase. So our vault 1 is also up and we can see the status is ready. Let's port forward again. If you see the vault status now, we can see our HA is already enabled and HA mode is active and currently active node is vault 2. Now, if you try to delete all the nodes, let's see what happens here. Now I have just deleted all the nodes, vault nodes. They are terminating phase. So vault 2 is terminating, vault 0 is trying to come up, vault 0 is already up and running. Vault 1 is up. Now let's wait for the Vault 2 to come up. It's in initializing phase. Vault 2 should be ready soon. All the ports of Vault is up and Vault status is ready. Now, if you take a look at the PVC here, we can see our PVC data is still there. So Vault is actually persisting its data using the PVC. So no matter what we delete all the ports, the data will still be there. And user can restore his data if it's needed before deleting the Vault. So we have demonstrated the failover Vault feeder. Now let's take a look at how we can prevent accidental deletion of Vault server. Now, if I want to delete the Vault server, let's see what's going to happen. Oops, we can't delete it, right? Why? As I show you earlier, our Vault server policy, termination policy is set to do not terminate. So if you even somehow attempt to delete your Vault server, but if you set the termination policy to do not terminate, the Vault server, the kubevault operator will not let you terminate using mutating webhook. So if you really want to delete your Vault server, you need to change the termination policy to wipe out or delete or any other according to your necessity. So let's change the termination policy from do not terminate to wipe out. Let's patch it. So I'm here patching my termination policy from do not terminate to wipe out. Now the termination policy should be patched. Now let's try to delete the Vault server again. Nice. So we are successfully able to delete our Vault server now because the termination policy has been successfully changed. So we are planning to back up the Vault data using Stash, which should be coming soon. And of course, it will be announced and notified to everyone. So that was all for the demo part. Now, if you have any question, please feel free to go ahead. We'll try our best to answer your questions.
Thank you, Saqib. That's a great demo. So you already have a couple of questions in the Zoom chat. So I'll go over those. The first question from Babuni Raut. Sorry if I butcher your name, but I'll try to say it as clearly as I can. So the question is, can you use kubevault on OpenShift? If yes, what is the operator name for OpenShift to use kubevault? Yes, so you can use kubevault on OpenShift. You know, as you saw, the installation mechanism is just a Helm chart. So you can run those Helm commands and you'll be able to deploy kubevault in your OpenShift cluster. Currently, kubevault is not available in the Operator Hub website. So, but you know, we're going to add it there fairly soon. But for now, you can go to our website, kubevault.com, and run those Helm commands to deploy it. And the other question I have from Kirk Sullivan. So he said that the trial version has a different namespace. Can you use a get a different license to install in a different namespace? So just to clarify, so kubevault has a free to use community version, and the source code is available on our GitHub repo under the kubevault.org. So here, so the community version, you can deploy and manage your Vault server in the default namespace. So you'll you get a license for 1 year, and then you can basically, every time you can issue a new license, and that will be another year from that point. So anytime you issue a license, you'll get a 1 year license, and you will be able to just keep using it. Frankly, we are looking to release a Vault release every few months. So I mean, if you keep up with that, you probably can just deploy a new or getting your license every time you deploy or upgrade your Vault server. I mean, at least with the version of, you know, every time Kubernetes comes out, you can just update it. We're also working on a process to automate that. That's not available right now, but it'll be available soon, fairly soon. So then you will be able to, you don't even have to think about updating your license key. It'll just automatically update as long as you are registered with our site. If you want to run Vault on any namespace, effectively like manage your whole cluster and kind of really use this in a, you know, production system, you can get a trial license. You can get an enterprise license from us. So the license comes with a 30-day free trial. So during that period, you'll be able to, you know, just try it out. I mean, frankly, the community version has a lot of the same features, but the trial version has all the enterprise trial has all the features enabled. It's just time limited. And then within that period, you can, you know, purchase a license. You can always reach out to us through this email address, hello@appscode.com or support@appscode.com, and we are happy to work with you on that. So what happens if you actively seal Vault? Does KubeVault unseal it automatically? Saki, do you want to answer that?
Okay, so if you manually seal the Vault using the Vault seal command, the KubeVault will not automatically unseal it for you. You need to automatically provide the unseal command again. So it's the Vault specific way of unsealing Vault and the sealing it again. So it's possible to configure it like that. So if you provide the Vault seal command, then it can be unsealed.
Yeah, but I will also add that Vault will automatically, so the KubeVault operator, I mean, you know, so it's a question like how much you want to automate, right? So when you are using KubeVault operator, you know, when the pods restart and all of that happens, any kind of unseal or initialization that needs to happen, that will be done automatically. So, yeah. So those are the three questions. Is anybody else have any other question? You should be able to unmute yourself and ask a question, or maybe ask in the Zoom chat. Do we have any question in the Google slide that we had? I think I have to go back, like go to the present mode and go from there. Doesn't look like we have any questions there. So if you have any other question, you can always reach out to us through our email. You can follow us on Twitter to keep up to date with the project. You know, keep yourself up to date with the project. You know, it's a open core project, so you can see the available open source code on the GitHub org. The documentation, all the instructions or demo you saw is actually documented on our website, kubevault.com. So thanks for joining. I don't see another question. So thanks everybody for joining. Hope to see you again next time. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, everyone.